YouTube, this is Beginner's Guide to GPG, Lesson 4, Basic GPG Theory. In the last lesson, we installed our Linux machine, so now we'll be ready to learn about what GPG is exactly. What is GPG? GPG is the GNU GPL version of PGP. Pretty good privacy. PGP is the data encryption and decryption computer program that provides cryptographic privacy and authentication for data communications. PGP is often used for signing, encrypting, and decrypting text, emails, files, directories, and whole disk partitions, and to increase the security of email communications. It was created by Phil Zimmerman in 1991. PGP and similar software like GPG follow the OpenPGP standard RFC 4880 for encrypting and decrypting data. It has the upside of being very secure, and it has the downside of poor usability, which we'll find out as we continue to use it. In this course, we'll be practicing using GPG with Thunderbird and iStuff. iStuff is basically Thunderbird for Debian. We'll also be using Enigma, which is a popular add-on for both of those, as well as the command line GPG tool. With GPG, you must be using the same version of GPG as your associates. For this course, we will use the more modern GPG 2.whatever program. At the moment, it's 0.22, I think. In the future, it'll be 2.1. Symmetric encryption. One private key is used to both encrypt and decrypt the data. In the olden days, spies would share symmetric keys face-to-face before going on missions. So here we have two spies. They've each shared the master key, which they carry around on them, and they use it to encrypt and decrypt messages. Awesome. But the question remained, how do you securely encrypt messages between two people who've never met? If you transmit your master key, and it's intercepted by someone, they could decrypt all of your messages as well. Asymmetric encryption turned out to be the answer to this problem. Asymmetric encryption. Two keys exist, A and B. These are called a key pair, your key pair. They are mathematically related so that files encrypted with A can only be decrypted with B. Also, files encrypted with B can only be decrypted by A. It isn't possible to guess A if you have B and vice versa. We then call one of these keys a private key and the other key a public key. Our private key, we make sure to keep extra safe. Our public key is then broadcasted to other people, so we don't have to meet them in person. Now you might be wondering, if you're sending a public key to people, does that mean they can decrypt your messages? No, it does not, since both users have a key pair each, so that's four keys in total. They each encrypt the messages with the other person's public key. Decryption is therefore only possible with the recipient's private key, which, as we mentioned, is kept private and secure. Yeah, if you don't understand this section, feel free to revise it. Example, we start off with Adam and Bill, who create a key pair each. Awesome. Before we continue with this example, we should discuss GPG's main weakness. GPG will be ineffective if the user's end machine that has access to the private key has been compromised or hacked, has had a keylogger installed on it or something like that. This is why you need to use open source GPL computing systems for this course. I would actually say that's not enough. You should always endeavor to keep your machine secure. This involves playing with stuff like firewalls, firejail, AppArmor. Making sure you don't install software that's not from the default repositories, etc., etc. They each exchange public keys, so they've generated their key pair and they've given each other their public key. This can be done by any method you could possibly imagine. Remember, there's no risk in sharing your public key. It's meant to be shared. It's only your private key that needs to be secured. Here we see an example of a message being sent. Adam encrypts his message to Bill with Bill's public key. Bill then decrypts it with his own private key. And you can see in this example, Bill is the only person with his private key, so therefore he's the only person who can read it. And that's basically how it works. Here we see the vice versa. Bill wants to send a message to Adam, so he gets Adam's public key and he encrypts it with it. Adam then decrypts it with his own private key. Now, if some people are out there and they know a bit more about GPG, they might be wondering if I'm going to mention session keys. I'm not. I'm just going to have this sort of simplified explanation. You really don't need to know about session keys in order to use GPG. More than just encryption. Public key encryption, like GPG, provides more than just encryption. It provides authentication and integrity. Authentication allows the user to verify with good certainty that the message or file is in fact from the person who claims to have sent it. GPG can defeat attackers who are attempting to impersonate your associates. This addresses targeted phishing man in the middle of their attacks. Integrity. Integrity allows the user to be certain that the message was not altered by an error or intent during transmission. It's really important if you want to be really certain that your message looks the same on the other end. Moving along, your passphrase. Your key pair will be symmetrically encrypted with a passphrase. This allows them to be safely stored on your computer. It's also possible to store your own key pair in a remote offline storage device like a USB drive, although we won't cover this in this course. Whenever you encrypt or decrypt a GPG message, you will need to enter this passphrase. Be sure to set a sufficiently strong passphrase. Section 2 of this course defines how to make strong passphrases. If your password isn't strong enough, then GPG again won't be effective. An attacker appears. This is Eavesdropper. He is a powerful automated hacking machine, and he's already hacked you. He has intercepted all of your communications, and he has stored all of your unencrypted text. The next session will show you a little bit on how GPG prevents him from accessing the content of your emails. Scenario. Here we see that Eavesdropper has stolen both the public keys when they're being transmitted. He's also stolen all of the unencrypted text. Uh-oh. What can he do in this kind of scenario? What he can do is he can see that you're messaging each other. He can see exactly what time you're messaging each other. He might be able to see what external IP address you're both using. He'll be able to see all of the encrypted and non-encrypted emails. He won't be able to break into the encrypted ones, obviously, but he'll see them. He'll also see that you're using GPG. He'll also be able to impersonate your friends if he's able to hack into their email account using your public key. Ooh, that's not good. He'll also be able to see the subject line for each email, which, yeah, is a bummer. The subject line you write on top doesn't get encrypted, so keep it bland. Don't actually talk about what you're talking about in the message, otherwise it defeats the purpose. What he can't do, he can't decrypt the content of the emails or attachments. That's all he can do. He can do all that stuff above, but he cannot decrypt the actual content of the messages, which is good. You might be thinking, wow, he still sees a lot of information about our communication. Yeah, that's true. GPG is good for protecting the content of your messages, not much else. It's certainly not anonymous. In fact, the authentication actually makes it the opposite of anonymous. It is very secure, however. This is what Eavesdropper would see. He would see email addresses, what time, the subject line he would be able to read clearly. That one's probably a bit revealing, to be honest. He would also see the giant block of GPG text. Many possible uses. There are lots of things GPG can do. First, most obviously, is protecting sensitive data from unauthorized access. This is useful if you work in government or medicine or journalism or any other organization where privacy is important. Encrypting data that cannot be decrypted with your own private key. This is an interesting use. Basically, you can encrypt data for someone else while restricting your own access to it. A historic example of someone who would have done that would be Edward Snowden. He would have made sure that if he got captured, that he wouldn't be able to use his own passphrase or his own private key to decrypt any of the messages he was sending out to people. GPG allows him to do that. Authenticating people. If you were going to set up like an online voting system for an entire country of people, you could use GPG key pairs to actually authenticate users. Yeah, so you're sure everyone who is actually who they say they are. Finally, integrity, which is useful for guaranteeing messages when altered in transit. All of these features can be basically merged into larger programs because GPG is free software, and you can do whatever you want with it. Final activity is just to revise the section until you understand it. Next section, we'll be looking at actually using GPG with Enigmail, and we'll be sending our first message. other links to explain a bit about GPG. Feel free to look at those if you want. All right, see ya.